हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, इन दिस वीडियो वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट वेरिएबल प्रेशर और हेड टाइपोमीटर। वेरिएबल प्रेशर और हेड टाइपोमीटर। बिफोर दैट वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस वेरियस टाइप ऑफ फ्लोमीटर। व्हाट आर द टाइप्स ऑफ फ्लोमीटर? सो One of the types is variable pressure or head tachometer. Variable pressure or head tachometer. Second type is variable area tachometer. Variable area tachometer. Okay. And third one is variable area and pressure. Okay, so there are three categories of flowmeters. First one is variable area or head type flowmeter. Second one is variable area type flowmeter, and third one is variable area and pressure type flowmeter. Okay, now in some of the applications we need to measure rate of flow. Okay, rate of flow. For that purpose, to measure rate of flow, the meter, the flow meters are known as rate meters. The meters which are used for the measurement of rate of the flow are known as rate meters. Okay, and in some of the applications we need to measure quantity of the flow. In some of the applications we need to measure quantity of the flow. So the meters which are used to measure quantity of the flow are known as quant meters. Correct. Now in the rate of flow you may be required to measure velocity of the flow, velocity of the flow which is in meter per second. Okay, and in some of the applications you need to measure volume rate means meter cube per second, right? And in some of the applications you need to measure mass flow rate. Okay, mass flow rate. Which is in kilogram per second. Kilogram per second. Okay, so depending upon the unit of the flow, you need the devices to measure the flow rate. Correct. So if you have rate meter, then you can measure all the flow rates here. Okay. So if you measure the velocity. If you measure the velocity which is in meter per second, and again you need to measure volume flow rate which is in meter cube per second, then you need to multiply velocity flow rate into area. Okay, velocity flow rate into area. So if you multiply this with area, cross-sectional area, unit of area is meter square. If you multiply meter per second into meter square, then what will be the unit? It will be meter cube per second. Meter cube per second, and this is nothing but what? Volume flow rate. Volume flow rate, and this is represented by Q. This is represented by Q. Okay. So if you know already the velocity means flow rate, only flow rate of the fluid, then if you multiply the flow rate, which is in meter per second, to area, meter square, then you will get volume flow rate, and unit of volume flow rate is meter cube per second. Correct? Meter cube per second. Okay, now if you know already volume flow rate, okay? If you know already volume flow rate, that is in meter cube per second. Okay? So Q is known, meter cube per second. Then if you multiply this with density rho, if you multiply this with rho, and the unit of rho is kilogram per meter cube, kilogram per meter cube, yes, kilogram per meter cube, then what will happen? Unit of density, what is the unit of density? Is it correctly written here? Unit of density, kilogram per meter cube is the density unit. Unit of the density is kilogram per meter cube. Okay, if you multiply meter cube per second to kilogram per meter cube, then you will get kilogram per second. Kilogram per second, which is nothing but mass flow rate, which is nothing but mass flow rate. Okay, so if you know only velocity of the fluid, that is in meter per second, and you need to calculate volume flow rate, then you need to know the area as well. Okay, cross sectional area. If you multiply velocity with cross sectional area, that is in meter square, then you will get volume flow rate. And if you calculate volume flow rate, then you can calculate mass flow rate as well. Okay, to calculate mass flow rate, you need to multiply Q, that is volumetric flow rate, to density, and the unit of density is kilogram per meter cube. And if you multiply Q with rho, then you will get mass flow rate. Correct? Now area is easily measurable, but for the measurement of density, you need another device. Okay, if density is not known of the fluid which is flowing through some pipe, then you need to measure density of the fluid. Okay, so for the measurement of density, you need another device. So for the measurement of mass flow rate, you need another meter known as density meter. Correct? So if you know the unit and you need to measure different flow rates with the help of unit, then by simple analysis you can calculate different flow rate. Okay, here now let us come back to quantity of flow, that is quantimeters. So for the measurement of quantity, either you need to measure whole volume, that is in meter cube or liter, meter cube or liter, okay? Or you need to measure mass, okay, which is in kilogram. Okay, so there may be two types of quantimeters. One which can measure the flow in terms of volume or meter cube, and other one is other one is the meter which can measure the flow in terms of mass, that is kilogram. So these are quantum meters. Okay. Now let us talk about some units. One liter is nothing but 1000 cc. 1000 cc, that is cubic centimeter, and this is equal to 1000 centimeter cube. Okay, and 1000 liter, if volume is in 1000 liter, 1000 liter means 1 meter cube. 1000 liter means 1 meter cube. Okay, liter is nothing but unit of volume, and if you want to represent unit of volume into meter cube, that is conventional unit of volume, then 1000 liter is equal to 1 meter cube. Cubic centimeter is also the unit of volume. So 1 liter is equal to 1000 cubic centimeter, and 1000 cubic centimeter can be written like this also. Okay. So this is unit of volume. These are units of volume. So if these things are clear, then let us talk about rate meters. Rate meters. There are different types of rate meter depending upon the unit. Okay, you want to measure the flow rate in meter per second, or you want to measure the flow rate in meter cube per second, or you want to measure the flow rate in kilogram per second, right? So in the rate meter, first one is variable pressure type. Now we are talking about the flow meters with respect to the unit. Okay, so if we talk about rate meters, the flow meter first type is variable pressure type or variable head type flow meter. Okay, and second one, and in the variable pressure type, there are different flow meters in variable pressure or head type. Okay, so one is known as orifice meter, other one is known as Venturi meter. Okay, these are rate meters. Other one is known as P dot tube. Other one is known as nozzle type flow meter. Okay, other one is known as dual tube. Okay, other one is known as elbow tube. Correct. So guys, we were talking about variable pressure or head type flow meter, right? In this type of category, the instruments are orifice meter, Venturi meter, P dot tube, dual tube, elbow tube, and flow nozzle. These instruments are variable pressure or head type instruments. Now we have variable area type instruments and variable area and variable pressure type instruments. So there are three categories of instruments, and these meters are rate meters. These meters are rate meters. Okay, these meters are rate meters. Now, rate meters are generally based on the principle of obstruction. Okay, rate meters are based on the principle of obstruction. We create an obstruction in the path of the flow, and then we create a pressure difference. We create pressure difference in the path of the flow, and that pressure difference is calibrated into terms of flow. Okay, so how can we do that? There are different devices based on the obstruction type. Okay, so first of all, let us assume this is your pipe. Okay, this is our pipe, and we are creating obstruction in the flow of the path. We are creating obstruction in the flow of the path. Before creating obstruction, there is an area of pipe A1. Cross sectional area of the pipe is A1, and cross sectional area of the obstruction is A2. Correct? Cross sectional area of the obstruction is A2. Now, if area is decreased somewhere in the flow, then what happens? Velocity of the flow will be increased here at the site of obstruction. Velocity of the flow will be increased. Then if velocity of the flow is increased, then there will be change in your pressure. Higher is the velocity. If velocity of the flow is higher, then the pressure will be less. Okay, we know that area and velocity, equation of continuity, area and velocity product is constant. This is continuity equation. This is continuity equation. But the condition is that the fluid which is flowing through the pipe must be incompressible. The fluid which is flowing through the pipe must be incompressible. Okay, then the continuity equation will hold. Okay, now if area and velocity is constant and you are creating obstruction here, then area is decreased. If area is decreased, then what happens? Velocity should be increased. If velocity is getting increased, then pressure will be decreased. If velocity is increasing, pressure will be decreasing, right? So based on this principle, there will be pressure difference. There will be pressure difference created. Okay, there will be pressure difference created, and that pressure difference will be measured by the help of manometer. That pressure difference will be measured with the help of manometer. So the basic principle involved in the obstruction type of instruments is the flow rate will be directly proportional to under root delta P, and if there is a differential pressure and we are connecting manometer lens to these points. Okay, these points are called pressure tapping. Okay, pressure tappings are done to measure the pressure difference, and the manometer is connected between these points. Okay, manometer, one limb will be connected here and other limb will be connected here. I hope my point is clear. And if you are connecting manometer and there is a pressure difference, then there will be difference in the level of manometer in the manometric fluid. Okay, manometric fluid, there will be difference in level. Okay, so that will be directly proportional to delta H. It will be directly proportional to delta H. Okay, that's why the name head type flow meter, variable head type flow meter. Correct. So this is the equation which is, this is the principle which is involved in the obstruction type of instrument. Okay. Q is directly proportional to root delta P, and root delta P will be directly proportional to root delta H. Correct? Because we know that delta P for the manometer, delta P will be rho G delta H. Rho is constant, G is constant, so delta P will be directly proportional to delta H. And this relation is derived from Bernoulli's equation. Okay. This relation is derived from Bernoulli's equation. Okay. Continuity equation is already clear. Bernoulli's equation is already derived in another lecture. Okay. So I hope my point is clear here. Now, if we talk about volumetric flow rate, or for that matter only flow rate, that is V, velocity of the flow, V, okay, which is in meter per second. Okay, so V will be also proportional to root delta P, and this will be proportional to delta H. We know that Q is nothing but area into velocity. Q is nothing but area into velocity, and area is constant, so we can say that Q is also proportional to V, or V is also proportional to Q. Correct? Because we are multiplying area into velocity, and we are getting Q by doing that. Okay? Now, if this point is clear and we already know the Bernoulli's equation, then V, what will be V? Velocity of the flow, V, small v, V will be equal to A2 divided by root 1 minus A2 by A1 whole square, A2 by A1 whole square under root two delta p by rho, where rho is density of the fluid, A2 is the cross sectional area of the obstruction, A1 is the cross sectional area of the pipe. Okay, delta p is the differential pressure, rho is the density of the fluid. So I'm not writing all the variables here. Okay, v is the velocity. Now, If my point is clear, then this is your theoretical value of velocity. Okay. This is, if we are multiplying A2 here, then this will be Q. Okay. If you are not multiplying A2, then this is your V. V will be equal to 1 upon root 1 minus A2 divided by A1 whole square under root 2 delta P by rho. Okay. Now, if you want Q, then Q will be equal to, you need to multiply this with area, because Q will be area into velocity. Right. So, A2 divided by root 1 minus A2 by A1 whole square under root 2 delta P by rho. Correct? Now, this is your theoretical value of flow rate. Right? So, Q actual will be equal to, this is your Q ideal. this is your Q ideal. So Q actual will be equal to, there is a coefficient which is known as coefficient of discharge, CD. So CD into Q ideal. Okay, CD into Q ideal. If you multiply the theoretical value of Q with coefficient of discharge, then you will be getting Q actual. Okay. So CD is known as coefficient of discharge. Discharge. CD is coefficient of discharge. Okay. There are different CD values for different flow meters. CD is different for orifice meter and CD is different for flow nozzle. CD is different for venturi meter. The best CD gives, the best CD value is given by venturi meter. Okay. Now, delta P, we know that delta P is nothing but rho G delta S. So, Q actual will be equal to CD into A2 divided by 1 minus A2 by A1 whole square. And delta P is nothing but rho G delta H. So it will be 2 into rho G delta H divided by rho G delta H divided by rho. Rho and rho will be cancelled out. Rho and rho will be cancelled out. So Q actual, where Q is volumetric flow rate. Q is volumetric flow rate. So Q actual will be equal to CD A2 divided by root 1 minus A2 by A1 whole square under root 2G delta H. Under root 2G delta H. So from here, this is your one equation and this is your other equation. So from here, Q is directly proportional to delta P. Q is directly proportional to root delta P. Everything else is constant. A2 is constant, A1 is constant, rho is constant, delta P is varying. Okay. Similarly, here CD is constant, A2, A1 are constant, G is constant, only delta H is variable. So Q actual, or simply you can write Q. Okay. Q actual or Q is directly proportional to root delta P, and delta P is directly proportional to root delta H. This is the equation we were talking about. Okay. This is the equation we were talking about. Okay. So all the obstruction type flow meters are based on this equation. If we talk about orifice meter, then we will have to use this equation. If we talk about venturi meter, then again we will have to use this equation. If we talk about flow nozzle, then we will have to use this equation only. Correct? Okay. Now let us talk about orifice meter. Okay. One of the obstruction type instrument, or we can say this rate meter or variable area or head type instrument. Okay. Orifice meter. Now orifice meter is a metal plate which is having three categories. Okay. This is a plate and there is hole in between. This is concentric type. This is concentric type. And there is another type which is known as eccentric type. In eccentric type, the hole is not exactly in between, the hole is in the downward direction. Okay. So if the hole is here, then it is eccentric type. Okay. Another category is segmental type. If the hole is like this, then semicircular, then this is segmented type. Okay. Now, orifice meter is fit in between the pipe from where the flow is going through. Okay. In the path of the fluid flow, in the path of the fluid flow, or this plate is fixed. Okay. For example, if you see the concentric plate this way from the side view, from the side view in a pipe, let us suppose this is our pipe, and you fix the orifice plate in between, then it looks something like this. Okay, this is your concentric type of orifice meter. Concentric type of orifice meter. Hole is exactly in between. So by doing this, you are creating an obstruction in the fluid path. Okay, you are creating an obstruction in the fluid flow path. Okay, here cross sectional area is A1. Cross sectional area is A. Correct. Now, if we visualize these plates, there are three categories. For example, this plate. Okay, this plate. This is concentric type. This is concentric type, and the actual diameter, of the plate is like that. The diameter of the concentric plate is such that it fits the diameter of the pipe. Okay, it fits the diameter of the pipe like this. Okay, this is your concentric type orifice plate. Okay, here this is your concentric type, and the outer diameter of the concentric plate is equal to the diameter of the pipe through which the fluid is flowing. I hope my point is clear. This is concentric one, and this is eccentric one. This is eccentric one. Okay. In this, see, the hole is shifted downwards. The hole is shifted downwards. Okay. This is eccentric type, and this is concentric type. Correct. If we talk about segmental type, then it looks something like this. Okay. This is a segmental type. Okay. This is segmental type. All the three types have different applications. If the fluid is slurry type, then you cannot use concentric type. Okay. You will have to use eccentric type or segmental type. If the fluid is such that it contains some solid particles, then you will have to use eccentric type or segmental type. Right? What is clear? Because if you use concentric type, then the solid material, solid particles, which is in the fluid, then what happens? The solid material will stuck here. Okay? It may not go through the hole. Okay? That's why we have other two types, eccentric type and segmental type. Okay, point is clear. So the formula used to calculate fluid flow rate or volumetric flow rate is same which we derived earlier. Q is equal to CV into A divided by 1 minus A2 by A1 whole square under root 2 delta p by rho. Delta p is again written as 2 rho g delta h. So rho and rho will be cancelled out. You will have 2 g delta h. Correct. Okay. This is q actual. It's not theoretical because you have multiplied cd. Yes. Right. Now, A2 is the cross-sectional area of this hole. Cross-sectional area of this hole or this hole. Correct? So A2 is written as pi by pi r square. Okay? Pi r2 square. If r2 is the radius of this opening, if r2 is the radius of this opening or this opening, if r2, if you are using segmental, then r2 will be used as r2 by 2. Okay, r2 by 2. Or if whatever r2 is given, whatever r2 is given, then you have to make half of the radius. Okay, because this is semicircle. This is correct. Okay. A1 is pi r1 square. A1 is pi r1 square. Or in terms of diameter, we can write as pi b2 by 2 whole square. Means will be pi by 4 b2 square. Or pi r1 is d1 by 2, so it will be d1 by 2 whole square, pi by 4 d1 square, pi by 4 d1 square. So if this formula is written in terms of radius or diameter, then it becomes q actual will become cd into a2. A2 is pi r2 square. So let's write a2 here. It's cd a2 divided by 1 minus. Now here a2 by a1 square is there. Okay, a2 by a1 square is here. Then so it will be in terms of radius r2 by r1 to the power 4. R2 by r1 to the power 4. A2 by a1 will be equal to r2 square divided by r1 square, and a2 by a1 whole square will be equal to r2 by r1 to the power 4. Again under root 2 delta p by 4. In terms of diameter, it will be same. Same means cd a2 divided by 1 minus d2 by d1 to the power 4 under root 2 delta p by 2 delta p by 4. So this is your q actual in the case of orifice meter. In the case of orifice meter, it will be cd a2 divided by 1 minus r2 by r1 to the power 4 under root 2 delta p by 2. Now for the measurement of delta p, you need to connect manometer. You need to connect manometer. Before that, let us talk about its CD value for the orifice meter. Different flow meters have different CD value, as I told you earlier. So CD for orifice meter is 0.6 to 0.7. Coefficient of discharge for orifice meter is in the range of 0.6 to 0.7. Okay. Correct. Now CD for venturi meter. CD for venturi meter will be different. CD for venturi meter will be in the range of 0.9. Okay. So better is the CD, better is the flow meter. Okay. If CD value is good, then your flow meter is also good. So we were talking about the manometric placement, because you need to measure delta p. Delta p will be measured. Delta p will be measured if we place the manometer through the pressure packing. Through the pressure packing. So let me draw the diagram first. Okay. To fit the manometer, we need to connect the limbs of the manometer through the pipe. We need to connect the limbs of the manometer to the file. So one link will be connected here and other link will be connected here. Here pressure is P1, here pressure is P2. Pressure is P1 and pressure is P2. Okay. Now area is greater, what about velocity? If area is greater, velocity will be less. Area high, velocity will be less. If velocity is high, velocity is less, pressure will be high. So P1 will be after the obstruction, A2 is less. Let us okay. Now A1, we were talking about A1. A1 is higher, correct? A1 is higher, velocity will be less. If velocity is less, then P1 will be high. P1 will be high. So here P1 is high. What about P2? P2, if we talk about P2, then A2 will be less here. A2 is less because there is obstruction. Okay. If A2 is less, what about V2? Velocity will be increased. V2 will be high. If V2 is high, then P2 will be less. P2 will be less. So pressure difference will be created by this obstruction. If pressure difference is created, then to measure that pressure difference, we have connected this manometer. We have connected this manometer. After this obstruction, when the fluid flows some distance, again the pressure will be recovered. Again the pressure will be recovered by extra pumping. Okay. So you need to increase pumping for the pressure recovery. Right. If you do not pump more liquid, then pressure recovery will not be there. So you will have pressure loss. You will have pressure loss, and pressure loss is getting because of this obstruction. Okay. Pressure loss is getting because of this obstruction. Now, to measure the pressure difference, we have connected manometer. So from the manometer, P1 is high, so manometer liquid in this lamp, in this limb will be here, and in this limb will be here. Okay. Let us suppose P1 is, okay, P1 is high, right? P1 is high. So if manometer liquid is here in this limb, then in this limb manometer liquid will be here. Okay. Now from here we can measure delta H, pressure difference in the manometric fluid. Pressure difference in the manometric fluid. So from here you will measure delta H, and delta H, if delta H is measured, then we can easily calculate delta P. Delta P means pressure difference. Delta P will be nothing but rho G delta H. Delta P is nothing but rho G delta H. So in this manner we can calculate delta H. By calculating delta H, we can calculate delta P. Okay. And if delta P or delta H is calculated, then we can calculate Q by this formula. Now these pressure tappings, if we talk about these pressure tappings, should be such that we can calculate the delta P. There must be some pressure difference which is calculated by this manometer. Okay. So for that, the pressure tappings must be in a methodical way, must be in a methodical and measured way. You cannot make the pressure tapping by connecting the manometer anywhere in the pipe. Okay. There is some certain measurements, certain length where you can connect the manometer. Okay, so this is called as vena contracta. Vena contracta. This is pressure tapping. Pressure vena contracta is nothing but the pressure tapping. We'll talk about pressure tapping where we can connect the manometric limbs. Okay. Now, pressure tapping to the higher pressure side should be such that if capital D is the diameter of the pipe, if capital D is the diameter of the pipe, then pressure tapping will be such that one of the tapping should be at a distance 1D, one of the tapping should be at a distance 1D and other tapping should be at a distance 0.4 to 0.8 small d by capital D, where small d is the diameter of obstruction, diameter of the obstruction. Okay, so this is diameter of the obstruction. Pressure tapping, one of the limbs should be connected at a distance 1D from the obstruction. 1D from the obstruction, that is this length. This length should be capital D. This length should be capital D. Okay, and this length should be 0.4 to 0.8 small d by capital D. 0.4 to 0.8 small d by capital D. We are doing this because we know that small d is lesser than capital D. Okay, small d is lesser than capital D, and if we are multiplying small d by capital D to some 0.8 or 0.4 value, then this quantity will again be smaller. Okay, and this distance will be again nearer to the obstruction. Okay, this distance will be again nearer to the obstruction. Now, if this distance is not nearer to the obstruction, what happens? Pressure recovers here. Pressure recovers later in the later part of the pipe. Okay, pressure again recovers in the later part of the pipe. We cannot have more pressure difference. We cannot have more pressure difference. If we cannot have more pressure difference, then the manometer cannot measure pressure difference. Okay, manometer cannot measure pressure difference, and you will not get the value of flow rate, volumetric flow rate. Now let us talk about advantages and disadvantages of orifice meter. So the advantages are written here. Simple, the orifice meter is simple and cheapest. Okay, second one is this is easy to install because it covers less area, right? Disadvantages are there is more pressure loss. To understand the more pressure loss, let us understand about pressure profile of the orifice meter. So this is the obstruction and these are pressure tappings where manometer is connected. These are pressure tappings. Before connecting the orifice meter, orifice plate, pressure is P1. Here pressure is P1. So one of the limb is connected here, and after the obstruction, pressure is decreased and pressure will be P2. Pressure is decreased because velocity is increased, right? Velocity of the fluid is increased. So this is your pressure difference. Pressure should be like this, but because of this obstruction, pressure is P2. And this pressure P2 must be recovered here. must be recovered here after the obstruction. But in the RCS meter, pressure recovery is not good. For the pressure to be recovered, means P1 must be equal to P2 at some point of the pipe. Okay, so for making P1 equal to P2, you need extra pumping. This is the drawback of RCS meter. So pressure recovery is poor in the case of RCS meter. Accuracy is low. Not preferred if the fluid is slurry type. If the fluid is slurry type, RCS meter is not preferred. Okay, it is still used in the case of slurry type, but if you have Venturi meter, then you should use Venturi meter at the place of RCS meter, right? And the relation between input and output in the case of RCS meter, whether this is RCS meter or Venturi meter or flow nozzle, every case is nonlinear. Every case is nonlinear because we know that Q is directly proportional to delta P, and delta P is directly proportional to root delta P and root delta H. So root term is coming here, which is nonlinear. Okay, this is one of the drawbacks of RCS meter, and this is also a drawback in the case of Venturi meter and flow nozzle, right? So these are the disadvantages and advantages of RCS meter, and that is pressure profile. And in this, by this pressure profile, it is clear that pressure recovery in the case of RCS meter is not good. Okay, so this is all about your RCS meter, right? Thank you.